Molière's Tartuffe. This is a painting of Molière by Pierre Mignon from 1671. Mazarin was a chief minister while Louis XIV was young and was the symbol of the Catholic Church's extensive power in France. This image of Mazarin is by Robert Nonthieu. Louis XIV, also called the Sun King, consolidated royal power by upholding the divine right of kings, and became an important patron of the visual and literary arts during the period of his reign. The true measure of the cultural worth was the approval of the court and the Paris stage. Molière's troupe performed for the king in Paris in 1658, and under his patronage developed into the Comédie Française in 1680. The image you see on your screen is a portrait of Louis XIV by Robert Nonthieu. The monologue, which extends nearly 50 lines, is Molière's way of paying homage to Louis XIV, his patron, in hopes that his compliments would extinguish any threats of censorship or imprisonment due to criticism of the Catholic Church. It reads, "We're fortunate in leadership and laws. We have a king who sees into men's hearts and cannot be deceived, so he imparts great wisdom and talent for discernment. Thus frauds are guaranteed a quick internment. Our Prince of Reason sees things as they are, so hypocrites do not get very far." The image is Molière reading Tartuffe at the home of Mignon de l'Enclos, Nicolas André Monsieur. This 18th century painting of 17th century playwright is a tribute both to Molière and L'Enclos, an author, courtesan, and patron of the arts who was host to some of the era's most celebrated literary salons. Students might try to identify what topics motivate them to laugh, or what qualifies something as humorous. Is laughter innocent, or does it stem from something sinister within ourselves? According to Plato and Molière, laughter leads to the correction of human vice. Aristotle argues that laughter arises when something disgraceful or inappropriate is presented in a formal or appropriate way. Freud contends that humans laugh to release negative energies, such as shame, anger, and hostility, or because we recognize our own suffering or shame in the character that is struggling with those feelings. Umberto Eco, in The Name of the Rose, asks whether or not Jesus, who's considered an infallible human, ever laughed, as laughter, Eco suggests, stems from evil inclinations. In an introductory letter to the play, Molière wrote about the value of comedy to reform men's vices. Remember that during this time, tragedy was considered a serious art form, while comedy was relegated to crass entertainment. Molière was one of the first playwrights to argue for the usefulness of comedy. In response to this play's scathing criticism of the church, the Archbishop of Paris issued an edict proclaiming that anyone watching, performing in, or reading the play would be excommunicated from the Catholic Church. Many plays, whether comic or tragic, include an in-law, who acts as the voice of reason to the main patriarch or matriarch in the play. In this work, Cléante, as Argand's brother-in-law, acts as an outside voice of reason. He contrasts Argand as a more level-headed patriarch, but also contrasts Tartuffe in acting as a rational rather than spiritually corrupt advisor to Argand. "Your man and his life, honestly, are hollow. I believe you praise him quite sincerely. I also think you'll pay for this quite dearly. He's a fraud, this man whom you adore." Students might consider the opening character descriptions by Argand's mother. Though hypercritical, the portraits she paints are accurate representations of stock characters in comedy. The overbearing mother-in-law, the duplicitous guest, the stupid or narcissistic father, the coy wife, the cunning servant, etc. Subplots are minor plots interwoven into the fabric of the main narrative. In this play, for example, ensuring the romantic relationship between Valère and Marion ties into the main plot line of exposing Tartuffe's hypocrisy. Comic playwrights, to add complexity, will often create a sudden or unexpected twist just as the play appears to resolve. In this play, the unexpected appearance of Monsieur Loyal and issue of Argand's possession of a traitor's papers. All comic plays resolve happily, to the extent that life returns to status quo at the play's end. Notice that Argand is the final person to speak in the play, showing that the patriarchal figure has been restored, thereby bringing family back to functionality. The quotes here are taken from 1-1, pages 144 to 145, when Madame Pernell visits her son's home and criticizes every member of the family. In spite of her absurd contentions, the excerpt is helpful in identifying stock characters of comic plays. Students might read each quote above without referring to the text and try to identify the character and stereotype that he or she represents in this work. Go ahead and pause the video for a few moments and do just that. This image, circa 1795, depicts scene 3-3 in which Tartuffe places his hand upon Elmire's knee, ostensibly to feel the lace and fine quality of the fabric. In this scene with Tartuffe and Elmire, Tartuffe skews religious language and misrepresents courtship rituals in order to persuade Elmire to have an affair. Not only will he be more discreet than younger suitors, but he translates religious zeal into sexual energy. Students might examine phrases that have both religious and sexual tone in 3-3. For example, lines 3 through 4. Bless your soul and body, and may it grant the prayerful wishes of this supplicant. Line 11. Each fervent prayer wretched from my simple soul. Line 24. That I've begged heaven for, yes, this is true. Lines 29 through 36. I long to show you my entire soul, rather my own transports of zeal, which carried me away with how I feel, consumed my impulses, though always pure. Lines 72 through 73. Until I saw your beauty as a blessing, so now my passion can never be wrong. Lines 103 through 104. If my confession earns your condemnation, then blame your glance for the annihilation. You can also see it on the excerpt on the screen. Your honor has, of course, all my protection, and you can trust my absolute discretion. For those men that all women die for, love's a game whose object is a high score. Students should also examine scene 2-4 with care, not only because it represents the critical development of the play's subplot, but also because many students will be able to identify with the young lover's quarrel and stereotypical behaviors that our culture expects young men and women to exhibit during an argument. Note the gestures and atypical role reversal as Valère, rather than remaining calm and collected, refuses to storm out without looking back. On page 168, Doreen says, "It seems that lovers' tongues are never still." How is Molaire's text a prelude to Enlightenment thought regarding Christianity? According to the What is Enlightenment on pages 101 to 104 discussion, the period marks a time when educated people began to cast a critical eye on the pronouncements of priests and princes, who themselves had proven corruptible and fallible. Science and reason replaced faith and religion, which the thinkers had come to see as irrational and self-serving. Where do you see evidence of corruptibility, irrational behavior, and self-serving acts in the characters of Tartuffe and Orgon? Thank you for listening to my lecture. Bye.